Sharing, these are the agricultural technology presentations, you know, being facilitated by NAS Cell, IMB, and all other, you know, institutions involved in this. Basically, I work with the Center of Excellence for the Farmer Producer Organizations. It is one of its, you know, kind in the entire country. We are the only institution in the country to help and support farmer producer institutions in Karnataka. Our focus is in Karnataka state. And basically we try to link five FPOs with several actors in supply and market chains. Apart from this, one of the most important intervention that we do is linking farmers institutions with technological institutions. Institutions that are involved in research and development. Institutions that are involved in providing technological solutions to farmers institutions. So this is what we are trying to do. As you are all aware, Karnataka is one of the leading states that has promoted you know, close to 800 FPOs which are already registered and operating in the state, and another 750 FPOs are going to come up in the next 3 years of time. So we have both state and centrally operated schemes that support and nurture the FPOs in the state of Karnataka. And Center of Excellence, as a knowledge institution, we are trying to train, provide training and capacity building support to the FPOs, and also guide them towards, you know, linking them with best technologies that are available across the globe. In that regard, I would like to just briefly touch upon a few things which are our focus areas, and maybe these technologies, innovative technologies that can bring, you know, revolution in the sector of agriculture. As we are all aware, you know, agriculture is one of the most, you know, sacred professions, and the farmers are the founders of civilizations. However, farming sector is facing several challenges such as, you know, fragmented land holdings, rising cost of inputs, shortage of skilled labor, vagaries of nature, disease and pest outbreaks, changes in consumer preferences, and lot of constraints being faced by the farmers in marketing. Solutions are required for these challenges, and lot of technologies are addressing this. Technological innovations have offered solutions to these challenges and brought about revolution in agriculture. These innovations are nothing but applying ideas, knowledge, or practices that are new to a particular context with the purpose of creating positive change that will provide a way to meet needs, take on challenges, or seize opportunities in farming. So different types of innovations that are there in agriculture, and basically they include technological innovations, product and service innovations, market innovations, so on and so forth. KisanMitr is focusing on such interesting technologies for the benefit of farmers by bringing, you know, various technological institutions, startups, institutions that are engaged in developing new technologies that can really bring revolution in agriculture sector. I will try to randomly touch upon few innovations that have revolutionized Indian agriculture. And if you look at the soil resources, basically, you know, as we are all aware, soil is one of the most basic important requirement in agricultural production. I would like to start with soil as a base for all agricultural activities. Land resource inventorization technology, you know, this is very important technology, and this is being tried in Karnataka. Innovations in soil resource mapping basically involves detailed scientific study of morphological, physical, chemical, biological and hydrological properties of the soil. The digitized data is used for developing decision support system that guides farmers with scientifically sound and crop specific options, apart from providing suitable soil and water management solutions. Farmers can make use of this data for crop production, and the policymakers can make use of this data for planning. We have soil DNA testing technology. Friends, we are all aware DNA mapping technology is now being used in agriculture. Farmers can test their soils for microbes and organic matter. This basically helps in identifying harmful insects, nematodes, bacteria, viruses, and other pathogens that are present in the soil to predict and prevent possible crop damages. DNA tests used to be very costly earlier, but now they are more affordable and they can generate wealth of data that can be used for soil health analytics and which can give more transparent results to farmers about their soil health. If you look at micro irrigation technology, this is one of the most, you know, important technology that is the need of this country. Micro irrigation is transforming the lives of farmers across the globe. It efficiently delivers right amount of water and nutrients at the right time directly to the root zone so that the plant grows optimally. It helps farmers in fetching higher and consistent quality yields. Huge water savings, you know, is possible as there is no evaporation, there is no runoff and no water wastage. Soil use, the use of soil is 100% and the informed irrigation is possible in any topography and in the soil type, apart from saving the energy for application. This also facilitates efficient use of fertilizers with no leaching and with very less dependency on the weather. Karnataka is one state which has been very strongly, you know, promoting micro irrigation in most of the horticulture crops and in few agricultural crops. Let us look at the other important technology, precision fertigation. Precision fertigation is all about enriching the, you know, crops with right quantity, combination and timing for nutrient application. It indicates the right combination of nutrients and water directly to the root zone of the crop based on the crop development cycles. Thus, it ensures a comparatively higher quantity and quality of the yield. Precision fertigation injection system is also an alternative method towards controlling the fertilizer investments through tweaking the fertilizer dosages on demand in accordance with the requirements of the crops. These controlled fertilizer dosages would prevent issues such as groundwater contamination and leaching over and above loss of cost saving. If you look at the vertical farming technology, it is nothing but growing of the crops in shelves stacked one above the other in a closed and controlled environment, and it significantly reduces the amount of landscape and land space, you know, needed to grow crops. Vertical farming is popular in cities because of its ability to thrive in a limited space. In vertical farms, crops are, you know, mostly grown without soil, and many of them are either hydroponic, where vegetables are grown in a nutrient-dense water, or it can be an aeroponics, where, you know, plant roots are systematically sprayed with water and nutrients. In lieu of the nutrient in a natural sunlight, the artificial lights can also be used. You know, we call them as grow lights. They can also be used providing a required quantity of light. Thus,
Dr. Ashok, vertical farm. One request, sir.
Yeah.
Can you put this on slideshow completely?
You are not able to see that?
We are able to see it, but it needs to get a little bigger. If
okay.
That's possible.
I will do that.
Yes. Rest is good. Let's continue. Yes, absolutely. Let's continue.
If you look at the farm automation technology, or we also look at the farm mechanization, the farm automation is often associated with the smart farming, which makes farmers more efficient and it automates the crop production cycle. Automation includes use of drones, autonomous, you know, tractors, robots for seeding, watering and harvesting. These new advancements in technologies are ranging from robotics, moisture and temperature sensors, and drones to computer vision software. You know, major technologies that are most commonly being used by the farmers include irrigation automation. This is one of the important technologies that is being now promoted in Karnataka. Harvest automation, autonomous tractors, seeding, weeding, and use of drones. The benefits of automating the traditional farming processes are monumental by tackling the issues from consumer preferences, shortage of labor, basically the skilled labors, and the environmental footprints of the farming. If you look at the livestock farming technology, which is another important, you know, leading business in the state of Karnataka and most, you know, fetching profession for the farmers, this technology is revolutionizing the livestock management. The innovations include either nutritional technology, genetics, digital technology, and more. Such technologies can improve the productivity, welfare and management of the livestock in a better way. The dairy herds are fitted with the sensors to monitor their health and increase productivity. Putting individual wearable sensors on the cattle can keep track of the daily activity and health-related issues by providing data-driven insights for the entire herd and thus help, you know, making quick management decisions in livestock. So this is a very interesting thing, and farmers would be really interested to take any such related technology for managing their animal herds. If you look at the greenhouse technology for protected cultivation, the modern greenhouse technology is emerging in a large scale. They are capital infused and urban centers. Lot of central and state schemes are supporting farmers to adopt these technologies. In Karnataka, modern greenhouses are becoming increasingly tech savvy. They are using LED lights and automated control systems to protect, you know, tailor the environment, you know, growing environment. Successful greenhouse companies are scaling significantly and located their growing facilities near urban hubs to capitalize on the ever increasing demand for local food, no matter whatever the season. So this is one interesting technology that is helping the farmers to produce a very high quality food all throughout the year. Then comes our, you know, precision technology. Basically, we have seed house technology and many others. So agriculture is undergoing an evolution. Technology is becoming indispensable part of every commercial form. Precision technologies basically allow or help the farmers to maximize yields by controlling every variable of the crop production, such as moisture levels, pest stress, soil conditions, and microclimates. By providing more accurate techniques for planting and growing crops, precision agriculture, you know, enables farmers to increase efficiency and also help in managing the costs. There's a huge opportunity for precision agriculture. Tell me.
It's wonderful to hear you on this. I'm sure there are a lot of details that you'd like to share. However, for the want of time, is it possible to make a quick summary and probably close this in the next 5-8 minutes?
Yes, I will do that. I will not cross that 15 minutes time what you are giving.
Sure, please.
So we are also trying to look at the blockchain technology. The lot of FPOs, we are trying to help them to adopt this technology, because Karnataka is one state where we are trying to have a common brand and common brand for all the producers of the farmer producer companies. So this blockchain technology will help us in revolutionize traditional commodity trading and also in hedging. So this is one being tried now. And we also look at the artificial intelligence technology. And you are quite aware that the rise of digital agriculture has opened a wealth of new data opportunities. Remote sensors and satellites can gather crop information 24/7 over the entire field. And they also help us in monitoring the plant health, soil conditions, temperature, humidity. And such technologies are in lot of demand, and farmers are trying to look at these technologies. If you look at the drones, use of drones, you know, the use of drones for spraying and other things are one way, but drones are also being used as an alternative to drones. These basically honeybees. So we are all hearing about the media that the bees are disappearing, and some species of bees are even at the risk of extinction. So in such situations, drones are now being used in experiments to hopefully supplement the pollination efforts, that remaining bees are completing. And drones are also used for automated crop harvesting and also aerial drone photography and many other things. We also look at simple, cost-effective technologies such as insect trapping technology. We have several, pheromone traps, light traps. All such things are also being used in agriculture. Apart from this, we are also looking at high yielding varieties, especially when you look at the dryland agriculture situations. We are trying to look at use of high yielding varieties that are biofortified, so that the farmers are able to produce high quality yields and also they fetch better, price for their produce. We also have, weather forecasting technology. Weather forecasting technology is one of the most important, required technology for the farmers in the state. And we have Karnataka State Disaster Management Cell that is based in Bangalore. This is helping the farmers to really get, timely information about the weather, so that they are able to have very, you know, they can take quick decisions depending on the prevailing climate in the areas. And if you look at another important technology that is being, you know, attracted by the farmers is the hydroponics and aeroponics technology. We have both aquaponics, hydroponics and aeroponics that are becoming more and more popular in the state of Karnataka, and lot of, you know, people are trying to do, and we get lot of information, inquiry about these technologies. And anybody, I mean, any institution, any company, any startup having such technologies would be a great demand. And the last, before I close my this presentation, I would like to also throw a little light on the ENAM. It's basically a marketing innovation in agriculture. As we are all aware, ENAM is a national agriculture market. It's an online trading platform for the agricultural commodities which are grown by the farmers in the state. And this is also being tried in a different platform in Karnataka. We have for a Karnataka state, we have another setup made in the state of Karnataka that is also helping the farmers. What we are trying to do is we are trying to get all the FPOs and their farmers registered on the ENAM portal so that the marketing of their produce is also technology enabled. And you know, it has all attractive features such as, you know, MIS dashboard and other mobile payments, enhanced features on the mobile. They can also have the as a gate entry and payment through mobile phones. All these things are there. This innovation is really helping, you know, in creating unified national market for the agricultural commodities. And this can resolve several problems in marketing of the agricultural commodities. So like this, we can list out several technologies that are being now tried by the farmers. And we will try to, you know, link farmers. You know, we are trying to link farmers in the state of Karnataka with the new technologies, people who are providing these technologies to the farmers. And we would welcome all the, you know, startups, technology provider institutions, individuals who have, you know, disrupting technologies with them. We will definitely link them with the farmers institutions for their benefit. With this, I will stop here. And if there are any queries, questions on this, I would be pleased to answer. But one thing before I close, I would like to tell, there is a huge scope for people who are having a lot of innovative technologies with them. We will be able to facilitate you with the people who require technology, that is the farmers and group of institutions. So at least we are working with close to, you know, 10 lakh farmers. So that's a huge number. And but one thing I would like to make, if they are just theoretical, farmers will be very, I mean, skeptical to use them. If they have real relevant application, you know, advantage, but definitely it's possible that your technologies will be adopted by them, they can be showcased by them, and we can make a huge difference in the lives of the small and marginal farmers. With this, I take this opportunity to thank all the organizers, especially Mukta, for inviting me for this program. And I would be very happy to listen to other technology presenters. I am stopping exactly at the 15th minute. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. Pleasure hosting you and listening to what the FPO is doing along with farmers and trying to reach the last mile. And I would request the next speaker, Ms. Mamta, to begin her presentation. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, Mukta. Thank you very much.
Sure. We'll connect up offline to take this forward, sir. Yeah. Thank you. Mamta, over to you.
Yeah, sure. I'm just trying to share my screen.
Please. Yeah.
Is it visible?
Yes. Please go ahead.
Good morning to all. Myself, Mamta Sharma, and today on the behalf of CSIR CSIO, I would like to demonstrate one of our products in this webinar. As we all know that rice is one of the most common staple food for more than 70% of population throughout the world. And India has always been an agri-dominated economy. So the quality assessment of grain actually play a vital role in, you know, protecting the consumers from substandard products, because the sample of food materials are actually subjected to adulteration. And also it is very helpful to reduce the post-harvest wastage or losses. So in last few decades, we have all witnessed that introduction of technology in agriculture, yet the grain grading process has been manual, which is very cumbersome and often subjective also. So we realized that there is a lot of scope and gap where not much has been done yet. Here, using our skill set in technology, we thought of to come up with a solution that would help the farmers and the agri industry in a broader way. We was trying to provide a solution for the quality assessment of the grain. Just a minute. So here I would like to project the problem statement. We try to bring you in, in a revolutionary software for green industry, specially designed for the rice mill owners or rice exporter and rice importers. So this software, yeah.
I have a small request.
Yeah, sure.
While the problem statement here is written in detail, maybe you can make it a little crisp to save on time, right? And then you can go on to how you're looking at resolving it. Maybe you would want to focus more on how you're resolving it, because that's your software, right? That's so, what it's trying to say. Yeah.
Okay. So should I demonstrate a little bit? Like, should I go into the...
Yeah, you can just talk about the problem statement in 2-3 points, because it's there for everyone to read. And then you can go on to the solution, which is your software, right?
Okay. Fine.
Yes.
So here, actually, as we all know that rice marketing and trading in domestic and international market is very, deeper. So the software we had developed do the morphologic analysis of the rice grain after the post-harvest of rice, that is a staple food. And the dimension analysis basically consisting of the physical parameters. It rely on the physical parameter of the rice grain, like its length, breadth, LB ratio, whiteness, and the chalky percentage. So we originate the idea with the help of Rice Research Center, FCI, and the state level federation, Rice Miller, and a local rice marketing organization. And we end up to reach a solution where we just try to develop a software that is actually in an intermediate stage right now. We have earlier developed the two version of the same software, and that has been provided to market. And right now, third version is in an intermediate state. So I would just like to, tell you just few unique features of the software we have developed. This is the, just an idea of it. The system just need a, computer and a scanner to take the images of the sample, and further it would get analyzed. So the software is inexpensive, efficient, repeatable, and it has a database to store the huge amount of data for further use also. Results once obtained can be exported in Excel and other formats, and can be taken print out to circulate as it is required. This software has been copyrighted with CSIO, CSIR. Absolutely, it produces absolute and accurate results, and it provides very flexible, user-friendly, and easy to learn intuitive GUI, so that everyone can easily get to use it and get advantage out of it. So these are the few more features of the application. It has Zoom feature also, that is not available with the other application in the field with the same process. This software is a low-cost software that can make an easy replacement for any other existing expensive software, because right now in market there are few softwares that are present. but our initiative was to make it more flexible, to make it more user-friendly, and should be inexpensive for the user. So this is what the key features of our application. So should I explain the methodology also? Okay, sure. So what is the methodology actually is, we just need a computer and a scanner, more than 300 DPI to take the sample of the, of the rice grain, where we actually need to spread the sample in a way that it should not touching each other. So the scanner can have the capacity of taking 100 to 1000 range of sample of rice grain at one time as a sample. So the develop algorithm actually helps to evaluate and grading the rice grain on the basis of their size, shape, using the digital image processing techniques. Once the analysis has been done, it will take only few fraction of second to analyze all the sample grains in a particular sample, and it will provide the results in a tabular or in a graphical display that would be more user friendly and that can be exported and saved for further use. So if we'll talk about the current stage of the software which we have developed and is actually we are working on it, the licensing agreement, we have done it with Ambala Associate, that is an agrotech company based in Ambala, Haryana. And we have given two versions of the same applications to them till now. And right now we are working on the third version of the same application, where we are trying to incorporate few more features that we have, realized with the feedback of the users or with the feedback of the, with whom we are associated. Now we are trying to incorporate more features that are actually required with this software. So this application is actually tested in-house, and the results has been tested with the help of vernier calipers also, because till now all the millers are using the manual process of doing this quality assessment with the help of vernier calipers, and they required skilled persons, and it's a long long time taking process of doing this. So we try to evaluate our results by comparing them with the manual testing process also, so that we can come up to the accuracy of softwares, and the results till now found to be in agreement with good standards. So right now, obviously, we are seeking funding, because funding is required to scaling up the application and to work more and to reach the market. We absolutely want to reach to the market, because we want the software to be reached to the hands where it is actually required. So training and technical support for handholding will be provided by the CSIR, CSIO. And we are ready to technology transfer or to licensing agreement for the commercialization of the application. So this is our contact information. If in case we want to reach it out, so we have a business development group, which will be, in a helping hand to provide into more deeper aspects of the, project. Now, these are the simple screenshots just to have an idea or the overlook of the application, that how it would look like. So these are the few screenshots. I just want to, go through it just to let you get aware of what it is actually. So this is the main GUI. So sample would be scanned here, and these are the few options with the help of this user can perform the analysis. This would be kind of results that would be displayed to user. Even the results would be displayed in a tabular form also. These are the grain sample analyzed. These are the tabular information belonging to each and every grain. And in journal, if they want to look into the specific grain for particular information, so here each and every grain is associated with its physical parameters like length, breadth, LV ratio, chalky and whiteness also. So yeah, this is a software which I wanted to demonstrate here, and now I would like to rest my speech. If I wish that it would be would be that informative that was required here.
Thank you so much, Mamta. Would you like to share the details of your organization and your product probably on the chat for everyone to reach out to you? I think that would really help. And if the audience has any questions, please feel free to put it on the chat and the speakers will respond to your queries on the chat.
Yeah, sure. So this is my organization, that is CSIR, CSIO Chandigarh. So you can reach us on the mail ID.
On the chat also, Mamta.
Yeah, sure. Please, sorry.
Reach us on the chat. Share these body mails on the chat as well.
Yeah, sure. Yeah.
All right. Thank you so much. So after listening to Mamta's solution on the software, and we now go on to the next speaker, Mr. Rahul.
Hi.
Rahul, hi.
Hello. Everybody.
Please go ahead and share your pharmacentric solution.
Sure. So it's visible?
Yes, it is. Please put it in the slide mode and we're good to go. Yeah. I'll reach out to Nabi as well.
Sure.
And we'll take care of that afterwards.
Sure.
Post Rahul, we'll have Rajiv's presentation. Over to you, Rahul.
Okay.
Dr. Ashok, if you have any queries, please feel free to put it on the chat and you request you to share the details as well of your coordinates so people who want to reach out to you will do the same. Over to you,
Thank
Rahul.
You. Thank you. Okay. So, good morning, everybody. My name is Rahul Bakre and I'm the CEO of Urdhvam Environmental Technologies Private Limited, based out of Pune. We are a groundwater sustainability technology and products company. I'll be talking most about today our first product called as bore charger, which is into reviving of existing low yielding and failed bore wells. So we are incubated and accelerated for last 2 years by IIM Ahmedabad, Startup Oasis, Fulgro, Social Alpha, IIT Hyderabad as well, and IIM Kashipur. So as you guys know, India is the world's largest user of groundwater, and through 4.5 crore existing borewells and 20 lakh new borewells are drilled every year, India is abstracting groundwater mindlessly. So much so that 54% of groundwater wells are dying pretty fast. What are the recent groundwater issues in news? In Maharashtra, water crisis is everywhere. Borewells are going dry in the state, especially in the late Rabi and summer season. Bangalore, illegal drilling of borewells is happening and they are going up to 1500 feet. People are not able to get sufficient drinking water, especially in Karnataka, and they have become helpless. And day by day, the water levels are going down in places like Hyderabad and entire peninsula like India as such. So we have developed a patented, unique, smart, affordable rainwater harvesting technique called as bore charger. I'll just walk you through the animation. When the rainfall happens, the topmost part of the aquifer system takes the water pretty quickly. Up to 50 feet, it takes only a few days. But up to for that water to reach up to 200 feet, it takes hundreds of years. And to go up to 600 feet, it takes thousands and thousands of years. So when a borewell is drilled up to 200, 600 feet, a hole is made. And the topmost part of the hole, up to the first hard rock layer, is sealed with something called as a casing pipe. It's an impervious pipe so that the debris from the topmost side should not go into the borewell. It does the work, but it also doesn't allow any fresh supply of water from that depth. So borewell's recharge is lesser and abstraction is fast. So borewell typically give good water initially, but slowly they start giving lesser and lesser water because the supply of the deeper aquifers is much lesser compared to our electromechanical pumping as such. So that's why initially borewells give good amount of water, but slowly start they becoming seasonal and many of them, they also become dead in this process. So we have developed a unique process called as bore charger in which we undertake through underwater camera system, we undertake a groundwater scanning, borehole scanning, and we map all the aquifer, different aquifers. And we also show that we train or we also showcase it to the farmer. And after that, what we do is that we put our patented robotic tool into the borewell. A trained hydrogeologist does this angioplasty of the borewell, wherein he or she makes the perforations to the casing pipe from inside at hydrogeologically appropriate depth, so that the water which is there on the outside also starts getting into the borewell, and this water falls up to the 200, 600 feet depths, from where we have taken crores of liters of water out. So that though the borewell is dead, it has the storage potential and capacity, just that it is not getting recharged. And through this artificial injection recharge, we are able to take the water from the topmost aquifer and reach up to the lowermost points in the borewell. And that space, that void, is getting stored with lakhs and lakhs of liters of water every year without any maintenance, thereby reviving the existing failed and low yielding borewells. So this is a this is an example of the borewell. While it is making the perforations are being made, you can see the water starts coming from outside. It exists outside, but it's not able to come into the borewell. And this is lakhs and lakhs of liters of water. These are some of the few successful implementations. After we make the perforation, water from the outside topmost aquifer goes into the borewell and it falls to the lower aquifers and it gets stored there, thereby increasing the longevity and yield of the failed borewells. So what are the socioeconomic and ecological impacts? We are able to increase the recharge rate 4 to 20 times compared to what naturally is able to do. We are able to artificially inject between 2 lakh to 80 lakh liters of water every year in every borewell. This is a 90-95% success rate what we have seen. And apart from quantity, it has also has improved the water quality, and that has reduced the salination of soil. And obviously, because of so much of recharge, the vulnerability of farmer also has been reduced due to weather shocks. We have we also believe that this improvement in water level also will reduce the pumping energy costs and would increase the farm output as well. And in an urban or even a village context, it has also shown to reduce cost of tanker water. So what has been traction in last 24 months? We have done 1450 implementations in 9 states in India, as well as internationally in West Africa as well. And we have potentially recharged more than 165 crore liters of water out through those 1450 plus implementations. We have impacted 65,000 plus number of beneficiaries, and the price of the intervention is quite affordable, between 18,000 to 25,000 rupees per borewell. And this is only a one-time affair for that. Farmer Nabi Saab, when we did his implementation in his borewell, we could see the water level rising from 450 feet to 150 feet in a matter of few days. And the pumping hours increase in the month of summer from 15 minutes to 6 hours. And we were able to recharge tremendous amount of water in his borewell. In an urban context, near Hyderabad, we were able to improve the pumping from 1 hour per day to 6 hours per day in the dead heat of summer. We also have won a prestigious award and an order from Government of Maharashtra, where we implemented 100 bore charger implementations in drought-prone regions of Marathwada, and we were able to increase the water supply and water level drastically, so much so that the tanker, those villages and the town became tanker-free. So we have experience in working on government schemes as well. So what is the supply augmentation competition? It's typically the pit type borewell, where a pit is made around the borewell and it's filled up with rudimentary sand filter, and then that water basically is filtered from a surface water or a rooftop, and that is given into the borewell for recharge. But the problem with the this kind of a competitive solution is that it is at least 4 to 10 times costlier compared to bore charger. It needs 8 to 15 days. Most importantly, it needs rooftop and surface water source. Without that, it cannot work. Wherein bore charger, we don't need any surface water source whatsoever. Civil construction is required, maintenance is required in case of pit recharge. And it can recharge only during rain season. But in bore charger's case, we can recharge for next 60 to 180 additional days as well. And this technology is patented. Our business model is that we have a head office in Pune and we have set up regional offices in Maharashtra. And through dealers, we are generating the demand. And we are, our regional offices in Maharashtra are providing the services to farmers, industries and habitations. But we are automating the technology to such an extent that we will be training local youth, rural youth, urban youth on the science, the technology. And we will also be providing the tool to these this para hydro professionals, and those would be going out and giving the service so that we can reach the length and breadth of the country. So that's our scale up strategy. So other hydrogeology services, what we offer is that we also undertake groundwater mapping for to develop water balance and recharge area, discharge area identification. We undertake groundwater scanning for to identify a location for a borewell or a open well based on science. In fact, we undertake watershed design and implementation based on hydrogeology. We undertake groundwater trainings, especially which are simplified, not scientific in nature, but very simplified for farmers, students, and NGOs. And we also undertake groundwater pollution studies as well for industries. We are working on multiple such products in future, and they will be brought they'll be released in next 6 to 9 months time. We have been awarded amply by multiple eminent basically institutions such as Columbia Global Center. We recently won a 50 lakh rupees worth grant from them. So specific ask from government of Karnataka or Alok sir is that we want to have pilot in projects between 300 to 500 board charge implementations in a specific geography, especially in villages for farmers, to FPOs, NGOs, and CSRs to increase their income and reduce their vulnerability, and in towns to make them water secure and improve their water quality. We want to engage and have would like to play a role in FPOs and the related government schemes, and training and deployment to NGOs, FPOs, and CSRs, and take the knowledge to the farmers. And lastly, we would like to have connections with farmer collectives in Maharashtra, Karnataka, Telangana, and Tamil Nadu to basically scale up our work. Founders, myself, Rahul, I'm from Michigan State University and I'm Calcutta. Worked in software IT for more than 18 years and 10 plus years in groundwater and water management. And my co-founder, Vineet, he's a hydrogeologist by education. He has done his MSc in tropical hydrogeology from Tübingen in Germany. And overall, we have a tremendous amount of experience across founders, mentors, and advisors. So with that, I would request you to be part of our vision to recharge, replenish, and revive groundwater. Kyunki jal hai to kal hai. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Rahul. Please share your details on the chat for others to reach out to you.
Sure.
And after that presentation from Urdhvam, jal hai to kal hai, I think that's a very nice line to kind of remember. Over to you, Rajiv, our next speaker for today. Rajiv, please go ahead. Rajiv is a founder, co-founder of Utix Gigabits, and over to him to share how they're going about creating and impacting farmers through this solution that they have on the disease and pest management system. Over to you.
Yeah, thank you, Mukta. I hope you can hear me. And thanks for inviting us and to be a part of the KisanMitr setup. So Utix Gigabits, the name needs a little bit of explanation. So Gida, it is a plant in Kannada, and bits is information bits. So what you're trying to do is trying to see if you can use leverage technology, provide information, and do something for the plants. And broadly, what we are doing is we are creating systems to gather data from the farms and provide in a step-by-step scientific knowledge for crop management. And disease and pest management system is part of that. And just to tell you, like, what exactly is the problem? And see, this disease and pest is a huge problem for farmers. If you look at the data and all, it ranges from 15% to 25% of the pre-harvest losses across crops. And the management is a challenge because, see, no farmer is going to stop spraying just because you tell them so. Or no, the world is not turning organic overnight, or nobody is stopping this chemical sprays and all that. So this leads to like tremendous problems, right? Like the problem of pesticide residues in the whole food chain and all that. So the question we are asking is, can we do anything better? Like, is there anything available which will allow us to do effective management and also provide in sort of like an early warning system for the farmers? Now the challenges, the the status quo is that, see, the technology exists in the sense that, see, Government of India has a lot of institutes and people have spent, there are a lot of researchers who have spent 30 years like researching an insect or researching a sort of disease, and they know what needs to be done. The only problem is that researchers cannot be everywhere. And then we ask the next best question, that can we take whatever the researcher has done maybe for one setup, and can you try replicating it across the setup so that each and every farmer can get it? Now, in India, you have like two tremendous revolutions post 2016. One is the availability of mobile data with everybody, because now you have geo plans. And second is the UPI, so people can pay you from the farm. So what we are seeing is that's a problem. It's a challenging problem, but yeah, the R&D exists, and a lot of R&D exists, so this is in a fact. The scale is a challenge, and the expert cannot be everywhere. So what we are doing is that we are talking to the expert, trying to see how these things happen, and then asking if we can do a system around that. So if you look at the image, there is an expert who is at the field and who is explaining what is happening to this. There's a curly leaf that is happening, but he has to go and explain it. So can we do something better? Can we really create a personalized system for a farmer, which will tell him what to do, and how do we manage to do that at a cost that will make sense for him? So this is the part of Yuktis Gigabit. So what we do is that we have sensors at the farm, which can give you very accurate micro weather data. And if you want, you can also make use of other data sources that are available. And then you put it through the model. So agriculture typically has three kind of people for our kind of a problem. One are the general agronomists, second are the crop experts, and third are the modelers. So we work, we take the models from the modelers and we run the analysis on the data that we have collected from the farm. And the models can be heuristics. See, people even have got like simple models, like if temperature stays below this line and if humidity stays below that line, if the rain happens, then yeah, you have higher chances of this disease happening. And this analysis will vary from disease to disease, and the sensors will vary. So what we do is that we set up one box or the device at the farm, and the farm, you can get sensor data from the farm. And then using that and your software, which is mostly an encoding of what the researcher would have done at one setup, you are able to deliver an early warning. And the second part is that, see, just giving early warning is not enough. You also have to see, one of the biggest challenges is that can you take people through effective chemical management, right? So one is that, okay, I'm trying to prevent losses. That is the farmer's view or the short-term view, right? There's also a big challenge that can we do something about all these residues in the food supply chain, and can we manage it better? So because right now what happens is that the farmer will go to the informal networks, the distributors, and people just keep dumping, right? So you have like agronomist on board who can look at all the data. Farmer can send data from the field using our mobile app. Then you have sensors and mobile app that is giving all this data. Crop agronomist software working on that data. And the results can be delivered back to the farm. Now, what kind of a people it is working for right now? Right now the cost of delivery is not, I would say, for everyone, right? So we are primarily working with the fruit and vegetable growers in and around Bangalore. And I think Dr. Ashok mentioned Bagalkot. So we are also working with people in Jamkandi FPO for grape. So right now it is available for grape, pomegranate, capsicum, and guava and cucumber in some bits, and tomato. And people pay at the start of the season. They can get the app. We get the device installed and they can start getting the early warning as well as the chemical management, and they can also expert and consultant if they so want to do that. So that is how the system works. And system does other calculations as well. Let's say you have 40 acre plots. Then you can also look at wind direction and say how to do the spraying. You can look at delta T and say what are the best spray timings for the absorption, right? If you have a forecast for rain, then you say, don't do the spraying right now, right? So it actually guides you, you know, step by step. So, and there are two views to it. One is, see, the agronomist kind of a view where people are experts and they would like a lot of information. But for the grower, it is more like a calendar that, okay, next 7 days, what to do, today, what to do, kind of a calendar. And easy and a vernacular language for whatever, whoever you are using. So right now we have Hindi, we have Kannada, and we also have English, which I'm surprisingly, a lot of people are actually using English version also. And what is the big source? It's not that, like I said, the R&D exists, and as a commercial venture, we are trying to solve what are the solvable problems and not typically R&D problems. And I think the biggest problem challenge here is, can you distribute at a scale? Can you make a system where people can call? Can people start getting data to what crop they are doing, at what time in the season cycle they are doing, and effective management, right? So who are we working with? Right now, see, we are working with people in Melur, in Chikballapur, in Chintamani, Kolar, Bagalkot, and Bijapur areas. And like I said, these are mostly what you can categorize as fruit and vegetable growers and maybe slightly richer people. So one of the challenge for us is also that, can we bring the cost of delivery down so that, you know, it can start reaching even people who are right now, you know, the cost of delivery is higher for them. So we, one of the models that we are looking for to do that is that working with partners. So we are working in Rajasthan with some partners and these guys are doing soybean, urad and all that. And there are some 8,000 farmers that we are reaching through that model. We are also working with TSRD, the Tata Steel Foundation. We are working with Syngenta Foundation in Nasik. We are working with Keystone in Nilgiris. So this is the like the partner model in which, you know, the partners onboard the growers, and the system, same system you can deploy using the partners and using the partners networks. And if you look at it, we see the possibility. See, one of the good things about a digital system becomes that you can scale it very effectively, right? Because the systems are already in place. So if you want to plug a new model, let's say like we did for soybean in Rajasthan, what would be needed? What would be needed is that some expert who has done soybean for quite some time and understands what kind of models would be effective, what things to measure and like that. And we can import that in the system and all the growers can start getting that. So everybody talks about technology, but let me also talk a little bit of the community aspect of it, that how such systems can work and what kind of people can make it work. So one is definitely is very much is the farmer, right? Because without his input, without his willingness to try, a lot of things are not going to work out. And there we are spending some time educating people about the uses, doing this Kishan Vartas and going to the field and talking to the people. There are also the R&D folks that you definitely need, because see, a commercial venture always looks for solvable problems, not intractable problems, right? That will go into the R&D domain. Then we have people who are general agronomists, who are sort of crop experts, generally don't tend to go and talk to people in the field, because even in agriculture, there would be 35 odd domains and you need general agronomists. And then you need people who have been working with farmers like NGOs, NFPOs and all that. So that's the sort of collaboration we look for. If you're an R&D guy, you know for sure some crop, you would need that expertise imported in the system and distributed to the farmers. Yeah, we can work together. If you're an FPO or NGO who have a lot of farmers suffering from some setups and you want the system deployed, yes, we can talk and we can do that. And of course, the growers who would like to try out this system. So we are Yuptix. We are in Bangalore. We are in HSR layout. And the number you can call, you also have a support email. And I will also leave my contact, so in case you would want to get in touch. So I hope I've given you an overview of this system, and we hope to talk to some of you outside of this meeting also. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that lovely presentation, Rajiv. Since you're on YouTube, I also suggest that you can go ahead and share a link of the work that you've been doing so that people will understand a little more. And I also keep this for open now to Ms. Mamta as well as Rahul, in case you have a video that you would want to show about your work. I think that would be really helpful. Reasons is we're trying to reach out to Navi, who is the farmer, and he's the one who's used Rahul's solution. However, he's having some challenges and he's not able to log in. He's got some network issues. So would you like to go ahead and share probably the work that you've done, if it's on YouTube? You mentioned you are on YouTube as well, Raji.
Yeah, actually, we have a YouTube channel. So there are a lot of videos there. So I don't know which one I can share. So what I will do is I will just give you our channel. Okay. And you can see the interaction, you can see the videos, and you can, you know, ask. I mean, we are all there. I mean, we have 1 second.
Mamta, I'm keeping the forum open right now. So in case you also have something that you want to showcase, you can do the same. Same with Rahul and Mr. Ashok.
Yeah. Do you want me to share Nabi Sam's video?
Yes, please. Okay. Would you like to do that?
Yeah, I'll do that. I'll share
Rajiv, can we show Nabi's video since Nabi is not able to join? He's the farmer without which, you know, all of this wouldn't have happened at all. The KisanMitr showcase of the farmer is a very important thing. How long would this video is? Hardly a few minutes.
Yeah,
please go ahead. Minutes. And post which, I would like Rajiv to share. Is that all right, Rajiv?
Yeah, no problem. I'm also looking for what videos to share, so fine.
Sure, you can have that ready. Please switch on the volume.
Complete हुआ. हमको 620 पे पानी लगा. एक इंच पानी. हम जो बोर स्टार्ट करे उसे चालू करने के बाद सिर्फ हमारा वो डेली आधा घंटा चलना बंद था. ये सिस्टम पे चल रहा था सर. कृषि मेला में दिसंबर 14 तारीख पुणे के अंदर ये उद्यम बोर चार्जर के स्टॉल में हम जाके देखे उधर बोर चार्जर ये कैसा है बोल के हमको मालूम नहीं था. इधर आके उन्होंने काम चालू करे. काम चालू करने के बाद हमारे पास ऑटोमेटिक पानी इसमें बढ़ गया और पानी की आवाज आ रही है. हमको ये जो बोर चार्जर जो होगा ना इससे हम बहुत खुश हैं क्योंकि पानी का सोर्स ज्यादा हो गया. अभी ये हमारे ये बाजू गांव के है किसान इनको दिखाने के लिए लाया मैं.
नमस्ते सर, मेरा नाम नबी साहब है. अब्दुल रहीम साहब नद्दो वाले राजेश्वर तालुका बसो कल्याण जिला बीदर. ये बोर रिचार्ज के बारे में हम पुणे एग्जीबिशन गए थे उधर देखे ये बोर रिचार्ज कैसा होता बोल के. हम लास्ट ईयर अक्टूबर नवंबर में 2018 में हम बोर इधर मारे. मारने के बाद हमारे पास सिर्फ पानी 15 से 20 मिनट तक बोर का पानी आके बोर हमारा गैप ले रहा था बंद हो रहा था. तो हम उधर पुणे एग्जीबिशन हर साल दिसंबर 14 15 16 को उधर एग्जीबिशन होता उधर हम बोर रिचार्ज के बारे में उधर देखे थे. वो फिर उनको कांटेक्ट करके अप्रैल 15 तारीख को हम उनको इधर इनवाइट करे आने के लिए. वो आके वो बोर रिचार्ज करे तो इधर हमारा एक रड्डी बोल के है उनका एक और फुलगुत्ते में राजकुमार सर बोल के है राजप्पा सर बोल के उनका करे तो इसका बहुत बेनिफिट होगा क्योंकि पहले हमारा 15 मिनट ही चलता था. अब ये करने के बाद अभी सुबह में डेली 9 बजे करंट आता तो 4 बजे तक हमारा बोर चलता. तो इससे क्या है हमारा हमारा लैंड का जो इरिगेशन है इरिगेशन लैंड है हमारा पानी ज्यादा होने से और क्रॉप भी अच्छा आ रहा है. मैं तो पानी कम पड़ता था क्रॉप नुकसान होता था तो इससे बहुत बहुत बेनिफिट है. ये सभी हमारे जो किसान भाई बोर किसके पास है उन्होंने ये बोर रिचार्ज करे तो बहुत फायदा रहेगा. मैं भी 2,15,000 रुपए जो खर्च करा 15 मिनट हमारा बोर नहीं चलता था. इसमें इतना ये है वो बोर रिचार्ज करने के बाद हमारा जो बोर चल रहा है हमको बहुत 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 इसका बेनिफिट मिल रहा है और उनको हम बहुत धन्यवाद देते हैं. क्यों बोलो तो हर चीज मिलता है. पानी एक ऐसा चीज है बहुत अनमोल है. वो पानी रहा तो किसान कुछ भी कर सकता है. पानी नहीं रहा तो क्या भी नहीं कर सकता. मेरा मोबाइल नंबर है 9844548196 और ये हमारा जो जमीन है इस्लामपुर गांव में है. तालुका बसो कल्याण जिला बीदर, और तुम कभी भी आके कोई भी किसान भाई आके हमारा बोर को देख सकते तुम।
Thank you so much, Rahul. So with your solution, you're actually able to increase the amount of water in the bore wells and then
with unlimited users and unlimited projects. Matrix 24. Matrix 24 makes it easy to create a project timeline and distribute tasks.
Yes, Rajiv, would you like to go ahead?
Yeah, sure. So this is a slightly longish video.
Thank you so much, Rahul. We were not able to have Nabi here. Dr. Ashok, Nabi was supposed to come in and share his journey. But since he was not reachable, we've had Rahul share the video itself. Okay, please go ahead. Rajiv, over to you.
Yeah, I'm sharing.
Sure. And please increase the, yeah, just put it on the view mode. Yeah, thank you. We are unable to get the volume, Rajiv.
1 second.
Sure. Not getting the volume as yet.
No, that's the...
That's the max it can go?
Yeah, 1 second. Let me see if I can switch the...
How did you just take off your earphone plug it will...
Yes, actually you should. Yeah. Okay.
ವೆಜಿಟೇಬಲ್ಸ್ ಮೇಲೆ ತರಕಾರಿ ಬೆಳೆಗಳ ಮೇಲೆ ಮೀನ್ಸ್ ಕ್ಯಾಪ್ಸಿಕಮ್ ಮತ್ತೆ ಟೊಮೆಟೊ ಮೇಲೆ ಕಂಡು ಬರುತ್ತದೆ. ಎಲ್ಲಾ ಸ್ಟೇಜ್ ಅಲ್ಲೂ ಇದು ಕಂಡು ಬರುತ್ತೆ. ಸಾಮಾನ್ಯವಾಗಿ ಇದು ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ರಸ ಇರೋದು ಈ ಫ್ಲವರಿಂಗ್ ಸ್ಟೇಜ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ, ಮತ್ತೆ ಫ್ರೂಟ್ ಸೆಟ್ ಆದಾಗ ಬರ್ಬೇಕಾದ್ರೆ ಫ್ರೂಟ್ ರಸ ಇರುತ್ತೆ, ಎಲೆಗಳ ರಸ ಇರುತ್ತೆ. ಸೊ ಅದರಿಂದ ನಮ್ಗೆ ಫೋಟೋಸಿಂಥಿಸಿಸ್ ಕಮ್ಮಿ ಆಗಿ ಶೇಕಡ ಕನಿಷ್ಠ ಅಂತಂದ್ರು ಇದು 40% ನಮ್ಮ ಇಳುವರಿಯನ್ನ ಕಮ್ಮಿ ಮಾಡುತ್ತೆ. ನಾವು ಹತೋಟಿ ಮಾಡಿಲ್ಲ, ಸರಿಯಾದ ಕ್ರಮ ಅನುಸರಿಸಿಲ್ಲ ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ ಇದು ಶೇಕಡ 80% ನಮ್ಮ ಬೆಳೆಗಳ ಮೇಲೆ ಹಾನಿ.
ಈ ಹಾನಿಯ ಲಕ್ಷಣಗಳೇನು ಸರ್?
ಈಗ ಹಾನಿ ಮಾಡಿದ್ರೆ ಇದು ನಾನು ಹೇಳ್ದಂಗೆ ಇದು ಸಕ್ಲಿಂಗ್ ಪೆಸ್ಟ್ ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ ರಸ ಇರುವ ಕೀಟ. ಈ ರಸ ಏನ್ ಮಾಡುತ್ತೆ ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ ರಸ ಇರೋ ಕೀಟ ನಮ್ಮ ಇದರಿಂದಾಗಿ ಹಣ್ಣು ಮೇಲಾಗಿರ್ಬೋದು, ಎಲೆ ಮೇಲಾಗಿರ್ಬೋದು, ಕಾಂಡದಿಂದ ಆಗಿರ್ಬೋದು, ಅದು ಸಾಮಾನ್ಯವಾಗಿ ರಸ ಇರುತ್ತೆ. ರಸ ಇರೋದ್ರಿಂದ ಏನಾಗುತ್ತೆ, ಎಲೆಗಳ ಮುದುಡುವಿಕೆ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ, ಎಲೆಗಳು ಮೇಲ್ಮುಖವಾದಂಗೆ ಮುದುಡಿಕೆ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ. ಮತ್ತೆ ಇದು ಇದನ್ನ ಏನಂತೀವಿ, ಇದೊಂಥರ ವೆಕ್ಟರ್. ಇದು ತಮಕ್ಕೆ ಸಾಮಾನ್ಯ ಟೊಮೊಟೊ ಇದ್ರ ಮೇಲೆ ಟೊಮೊಟೊ ಕರ್ಲಿ ವೈರಸ್ ಅಂತೀವಿ. ವೈರಸ್ ನ ಇದು ಟ್ರಾನ್ಸ್ಪೋರ್ಟ್ ಮಾಡುತ್ತೆ, ವೆಕ್ಟರ್ ಆಗಿ ಇದು ಭಾಗವಹಿಸುತ್ತೆ. ಸೊ ಇದರಿಂದ ಎಲೆ ಮುದುಡುವಿಕೆ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ. ಎಲೆ ಮುದುಡುವಿಕೆ ಆದ್ರೆ ಇದರಲ್ಲಿ ಫೋಟೋಸಿಂಥಸಿಸ್ ಆಗಲ್ಲ. ಫೋಟೋಸಿಂಥಸಿಸ್ ಆಗಿಲ್ಲ ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ ಸರಿಯಾಗಿ ಇದು ಆಹಾರ ಉತ್ಪತ್ತಿ ಮಾಡದೇನೆ ಗಿಡ, ಅದ್ರದ್ದು ಬೆಳವಣಿಗೆ ಕುಂಠಿತ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ. ಸೊ ಬೇರೆ ಥ್ರಿಪ್ಸ್ ಅಟ್ಯಾಕ್ ಆಗದಿರೋ ಗಿಡಕ್ಕಿಂತ ಈ ಗಿಡ ಏನಾಗಿರುತ್ತೆ, ಕುಂಠಿತವಾಗಿ ಬೆಳವಣಿಗೆ ಆಗಿರುತ್ತೆ. ಕುಂಠಿತವಾಗಿ ಬೆಳವಣಿಗೆ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ, ಸಾಮಾನ್ಯವಾಗಿ ಅದರ ಈಲ್ಡ್ ಏನಂತೀವಿ, ನಮ್ದು ಏನ ಕ್ರಾಪ್ ಈಲ್ಡ್.
ಯಾವ ವಾತಾವರಣ ಕಂಡೀಷನ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಇದರ ಹರಡುವಿಕೆ ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಇರುತ್ತೆ ಸರ್?
ಇದು ಬೆಳೆಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಸಾಮಾನ್ಯವಾಗಿ ಎಲ್ಲಾ ಟೆಂಪರೇಚರ್ ಅಂದ್ರೆ 15°C ಎಬೋ ಏನಂತೀವಿ, ಬೆಳಗಿನ ವಾತಾವರಣ 15° ಟೆಂಪರೇಚರ್, ಆರ್ ಎಚ್ 70% ಬಿಲೋ 70% ಏನಿರುತ್ತೆ, ಅವಾಗ ಇದ್ರು ಹರಡುವಿಕೆನ ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಹೋಗುತ್ತೆ. ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಇದು ಮ್ಯಾಕ್ಸಿಮಮ್ 32-35 ಟೆಂಪರೇಚರ್ ಇರತ್ತಂತನು ಇದು ಇದು ಲೈಫ್ ಸೈಕಲ್ ನ ಕಂಪ್ಲೀಟ್ ಮಾಡುತ್ತೆ. ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ ಈಗ ಸಾಮಾನ್ಯವಾಗಿ ಇದು 29°C ಇದನ್ನ ಲೈಫ್ ಸೈಕಲ್ ಏನಂತೀವಿ, ಈ ಮೊಟ್ಟೆಯಿಂದ ಪ್ರೌಢ ವ್ಯವಸ್ಥೆ ಕಂಪ್ಲೀಟ್ ಮಾಡೋದಕ್ಕೆ ಇದು ಬರೀ ಕೇವಲ 9-12 ತಗೊಳುತ್ತೆ. ಓ, ಎಲ್ಲಾ ಟೆಂಪರೇಚರ್ ಇದು ಕೂಡ ಬೆಳೆಯುತ್ತೆ.
ಇದರ ನಿರ್ವಹಣೆಗೆ ಸಾಗುವಳಿ ಪದ್ಧತಿ ಅಥವಾ ರಾಸಾಯನಿಕ ಏನ್ ಔಷಧಿಗಳು ಏನ್ ಹಾಕ್ಬೇಕು ಸರ್?
ನಾವು ಏನ್ IPM ಪ್ರಾಕ್ಟೀಸ್ ಅಂತೀವಿ, ನಾವು IPM ಪ್ರಾಕ್ಟೀಸ್ ನ ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಫಾಲೋ ಮಾಡಬೇಕಾಗುತ್ತೆ. ಮೊದಲನೇದಾಗಿ ನಾವು ಕಲ್ಚರಲ್ ಮೆಥಡ್ ಫಾಲೋ ಮಾಡಬೇಕು. ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ ನಾವು ಬೇಸಿಗೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಆಳವಾಗಿ ಉಳುಮೆ ಮಾಡಬೇಕು, ಆಳವಾಗಿ ಉಳುಮೆ ಮಾಡೋದ್ರಿಂದ ಏನಾಗುತ್ತೆ, ಈ ಥ್ರಿಪ್ಸ್ ಮೊಟ್ಟೆ ಏನಂತೆ ಪಿಪ ಅವಸ್ಥೆ ಅಂತೀವಿ ಅಥವಾ ಮೊಟ್ಟೆ ಏನಂತೀವಿ ಅದು ಬಿಸಿಲು ತಾಪಮಾನಕ್ಕೆ ಸತ್ತು ಹೋಗ್ತವೆ. ಮತ್ತೆ ಹಳೆ ಕ್ರಾಪ್ ಏನ್ ಬೆಳೆದಿರ್ತೀವಿ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಸೇಮ್ ಕ್ರಾಪ್ ಅನ್ನ ಬೆಳಿಬಾರ್ದು, ಕ್ರಾಪ್ ರೊಟೇಷನ್ ಮಾಡ್ಬೇಕು. ಮತ್ತೆ ಹಳೆ ಕ್ರಾಪ್ ಏನ್ ಬೆಳೆದಿರ್ತೀವಿ ಅದ್ರದ ಡೆಬ್ರಿಸ್ ತಗೊಂಡು ಅದನ್ನ ಏನ್ ಹಳೆ ಉಳಿದಿರುತ್ತೆ ಅದನ್ನ ಬೆಂಕಿ ಇಡ್ಬೇಕು ಅಥವಾ ಕೊಳಿಯೋದಕ್ಕೆ ಬಿಡಬೇಕು, ಇಲ್ಲ ಏನು ನಾವು ಬೆಳೆ ಬೆಳಿತೀವಿ ಆ ಜಾಗದಿಂದ ದೂರ ಇಟ್ಟಿರ್ಬೇಕು. ಇದು ನಮ್ಮ ಮೊದಲನೇದಾಗಿ ಕಲ್ಚರಲ್ ಪ್ರಾಕ್ಟೀಸ್ ಮಾಡೋದು. ಮತ್ತೆ ಸಾಮಾನ್ಯವಾಗಿ ವೆರೈಟೀಸ್ ಇದಾವೆ, ಥ್ರಿಪ್ಸ್ ರೆಸಿಸ್ಟೆಂಟ್ ವೆರೈಟಿ ಮತ್ತೆ ವೈರಸ್ ರೆಸಿಸ್ಟೆಂಟ್ ವೆರೈಟಿ, ಆ ತರದ ಟೊಮೊಟೊ ಮತ್ತೆ ಕ್ಯಾಪ್ಸಿಕಮ್ ನ ಸೆಲೆಕ್ಟ್ ಮಾಡ್ಬೇಕಾಗುತ್ತೆ. ಸಾಮಾನ್ಯವಾಗಿ ಇದು ಸಿಂಜೆಂಟರ್ ವೆರೈಟಿ ಇದಾವೆ, ಸಿಂಜೆಂಟರ್ ವೆರೈಟಿ ಸೆಲೆಕ್ಟ್ ಮಾಡ್ಬೇಕಾಗುತ್ತೆ. ಬೇರೆ ಬೇರೆ ನಂದಿಸಿದ್ವಿ ಈ ತರ ವೈರಸ್ ರೆಸಿಸ್ಟೆಂಟ್ ವೆರೈಟಿ ಇದಾವೆ. ತದನಂತರ ನಾವು ಈಗ ಹತೋಟಿ ಮಾಡಕ್ ಆಗಿಲ್ಲ ಇದ್ರಲ್ಲಿ ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ ನಾವು ಕೊನೆಯದಾಗಿ ನಾವು ಕೆಮಿಕಲ್ ಸ್ಪ್ರೇ ಹೋಗ್ಬೇಕಾಗುತ್ತೆ. ಈಗ ಕೆಮಿಕಲ್ ಸ್ಪ್ರೇ ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ ತುಂಬಾ ಕೆಮಿಕಲ್ ಇದಾವೆ, ಈಗ ಥ್ರಿಪ್ಸ್ಗೋಸ್ಕರನೇ ಆದಂತ ಕೆಮಿಕಲ್ಸ್ ಇದಾವೆ, ಥೈಮೆಥಾಕ್ಸಮ್ ಇದೆ, ಫಿಪ್ರೋನಿಲ್ ಇದೆ, ಇಬಿಡಾಕ್ಲೋಪಿಡ್ ಇದೆ, ಅಂತ ಅಂತವಾಗಿ ನಾವು ನೋಡ್ಕೊಂಡು ಯಾವ ಸ್ಟೇಜ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಇದೆ ಅಂತ ಪ್ರಿವೆಂಟಿವ್ ಪ್ರಿಕಾಷನರಿ ಮೆಜರ್ಸ್ ಅನ್ನ ತಗೊಂಡು ಈ ತರ ಕೆಮಿಕಲ್ಸ್ ನ ನಾವು ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಸ್ಪ್ರೇ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಹೋಗ್ಬೇಕಾಗುತ್ತೆ.
ಈ ಥ್ರಿಪ್ಸ್ ನ ತಡೆಗಟ್ಟೋದಕ್ಕೆ ಇವಾಗ ಏನ್ ಅತ್ಯಾಧುನಿಕ ತಂತ್ರಜ್ಞಾನ, ಸ್ಮಾರ್ಟ್ ಕೃಷಿ ಇರ್ಬೋದು ಇಲ್ಲ ಸೆನ್ಸರ್ ಬಳಸಿ ಏನ್ ಕೃಷಿ ಮಾಡೋದಿರ್ಬೋದು, ಅದ್ರಿಂದ ಥ್ರಿಪ್ಸ್ ನ ತಡಿಬೋದಾ ಸರ್?
ಹೌದು, ಖಂಡಿತವಾಗಿ ತಡಿಬಹುದು. ಯಾವ ತರ ತಡಿಬಹುದು ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ ನಾವು ಆ ಕೀಟ ಬರೋದಕ್ಕೆ ಮುಂಚೆನೆ ನಾವು ಅದ್ರ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಪ್ರಿವೆಂಟಿವ್ ಮೆಜರ್ಸ್ ತಗೊಂಡ್ರೆ, ಪ್ರಿಕಾಷನರಿ ಮೆಜರ್ಸ್ ತಗೊಂತಂದ್ರೆ ನಾವು ಕೀಟಬಾಧೆಯನ್ನ ತಡಿಬಹುದು. ಹೇಗೆ ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ ಈಗ ನಮಗೆ ಇತ್ತೀಚ್ ಸ್ಟೀಮ್ ಇಂದ ನಾವು ಸೆನ್ಸರ್ಸ್ ನ ಅಳವ ಮಾಡಿಸ್ತೀವಿ. ವೆದರ್ ಸ್ಟೇಷನ್ ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ ಅದರಲ್ಲಿ ಟೆಂಪರೇಚರ್ ಇರುತ್ತೆ, ಗಾಳಿಲಿರುವ ತೇವಾಂಶ ಇರುತ್ತೆ, ಅದನ್ನ ನಾವು ಮಾಹಿತಿಯನ್ನ ಪಡೆದುಕೊಂಡು ಮುಂದೆ ನೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ವೀಕ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಯಾವ ಕೀಟ ಬಾಧೆ ಅಥವಾ ರೋಗ ಬಾಧೆ ಬರ್ಬೋದು ಅಂತ ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಅನಾಲಿಟಿಕ್ಸ್ ಟೀಮ್ ಇರುತ್ತೆ, ಅನಲೈಸ್ ಮಾಡಿ ಅದನ್ನ ರೈತರಿಗೆ ಮಾಹಿತಿ ಕೊಡುತ್ತೆ. ಸೊ ಆದ ಕಾರಣ ನಾವು ನೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಬರುವಂತ ಯಾವ ಕೀಟ ಅನ್ನೋದಕ್ಕಿಂತ ತಿಳ್ಕೊಂಡು ಮೊದಲನೇ ಪ್ರಿವೆಂಟಿವ್ ಮೆಜರ್ಸ್ ಆಗಿ ನಾವು ಯಾವ ಕೆಮಿಕಲ್ ಮಾಡ್ಬೇಕು, ಯಾವ ಪ್ರಾಕ್ಟೀಸ್ ಮಾಡ್ಬೇಕು, ಪ್ರಿವೆಂಟಿವ್ ಮೆಜರ್ಸ್ ನ ನಾವು ಪಡ್ಕೊಬಹುದು. ಹಂಗಾಗಿ ನಮಗೆ ಇತ್ತೀಚೆಗಿಂತ ವೆದರ್ ಸ್ಟೇಷನ್ ಅಳವಡಿಕೆಯಿಂದ ಕ್ರಾಪ್ಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಅಧಿಕ ಇಳುವರಿನ ಮಾಡಬಹುದು, ಶೇಕಡ 40% ಅಧಿಕ ಇಳುವರಿನ ನಾವು ಪಡ್ಕೋಬಹುದು. ಹೇಗೆ ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ ಬರೋದಕ್ಕೆ ಮುಂಚೆನೆ ನಾವು ತಿಳ್ಕೊಳ್ಳೋದ್ರಿಂದ ಯಾವ ಕೆಮಿಕಲ್ ಸ್ಪ್ರೇ ಮಾಡ್ಬೇಕು, ಯಾವ ಕಲ್ಚರಲ್ ಪ್ರಾಕ್ಟೀಸ್ ಮಾಡ್ಬೇಕು, ಯಾವ್ದು ಪ್ರಾಕ್ಟೀಸ್ ಮಾಡ್ಬೇಕಾಗುತ್ತೆ ನಮ್ಮ ಬೆಳೆಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಅಂತ ತಿಳಿಸ್ಕೊಡುತ್ತೆ ಇದು. ಅದ ನಂತರ ರೈತರಿಗೆ ತುಂಬಾ ಉಪಯುಕ್ತವಾಗಿರುತ್ತೆ. ಅವರು ಎಲ್ಲಾ ರೈತರು ಏನ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾರೆ, ಬಂದಾದ್ಮೇಲೆ ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಸ್ಪ್ರೇ ಕೊಡ್ತಾರೆ, ಅದು ಬಂದಾದ್ಮೇಲೆ ಕಂಟ್ರೋಲ್ ಮಾಡಕ್ ಹೋಗ್ತಾರೆ. ಸೊ ಬಂದಾದ್ಮೇಲೆ ಕಂಟ್ರೋಲ್ ಮಾಡೋದಕ್ಕಿಂತ ಬರೋದಕ್ಕೆ ಮುಂಚೆನೆ ಪ್ರಿವೆಂಟಿವ್ ಮೆಜರ್ಸ್ ಮಾಡಿ ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಬರೋದಕ್ಕೆ ಮುಂಚೆನೆ ನಾವು ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಬೆಳೆಗೆ ಏನೇನು ಅವಶ್ಯಕತೆ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ ಯಾವ್ದು ಫರ್ಟಿಲೈಸರ್ ಅವಶ್ಯಕತೆ, ಯಾವ್ದು ಕೆಮಿಕಲ್ ಸ್ಪ್ರೇ ಅವಶ್ಯಕತೆ, ಅದನ್ನ ಕೊಡ್ತಾ ಹೋಗ್ತು ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ ಇದನ್ನ ಹತೋಟಿ ಮಾಡಬಹುದು.
ಓಕೆ,
so yeah, sorry, I could not find the crisp version, so it's the demon of demos, right? So
that's fine, I think this serves the purpose of how
GST starts with the problems, then right. What are the possible solutions, and then how technology can help, how the smart krishi can help, and how we are actually going into the field putting these things. So right. I have probably newer version, maybe I will share with you.
You must create one and keep it ready. So thank you so much, Rajiv. Good to see this a little more. I think the local crowd will definitely be able to connect to this. And with that, we come to the end of the webinar today. Dr. Mamta said she will share a video a little later. She'll make one. So Dr. Ashok, Rahul, Rajiv, and Mamta, thank you so much for being on this webinar and sharing your pharmaceutical solutions. You three have made a lot of impact as panelists, and Dr. Ashok, you seem to be leading this in different ways through the FPOs. So we will collect offline and see how we can work together. So we'll check a common schedule and then take this forward. For today, thank you so much for being here and sharing the solutions. Have a great day, everyone, and let's hope that we are able to help the farmers as we plan to. With that, we come to the end of the webinar for today. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone. Thank you. Bye.